You have seen their faces. So claims Erskine Caldwell and Margaret Burkwhite's 1937 hybrid examination of the lives of poor southern sharecroppers living in the midst of the Great Depression. Their piece not only elicits a series of affective responses in the minds and bodies of modern-day readers, but it also raises a number of questions about the nature of the document form more broadly. How can we problematize the role of ventriloquism through the use of arbitrarily assigned captions to the images of real people? How might the production of a singularized category of the sharecropper dehumanize the sharecropper's experience as both monolithic and static? And perhaps most provocatively, how can we understand the ways in which visual modes of knowledge production either disrupt or reinforce the categories of you and them? In this piece, I want to suggest that one of the most significant questions that Caldwell and Burkwhite allow us to think through relates to the role of the ocular and ocular centrism. Explored through the vantage point of disability studies, ocular centrism is often defined as the ways in which a modern American and/or Western social imaginary sets vision apart from other senses as the most significant sensory exploration that can be offered. I want to suggest here that You Have Seen Their Faces allows us to probe not only our own relationships to vision and the gaze, but also the ongoing ways in which vision both mediates and is mediated by the bodies that we occupy, the worlds that we live in, and the very process of viewership more broadly. It is through the visual that readers of You Have Seen Their Faces are invited to question the nature of their own subjectivity, their relationship to the people they deem others, and their understandings of embodied performance and consumption. Perhaps the best place to understand how the visual influences the construction of subjectivities in You Have Seen Their Faces is actually through an examination of the title of the work, You Have Seen Their Faces. On this subject, Jeffrey Allred writes,
"The title of You Have Seen Their Faces hails readers strangely as a you standing opposite a them in a manner suggestive of public modes of looking, of museums or carnivals. Places that offer a glimpse of the freakish and or exotic to a mass audience. Their use of the present perfect tense, however, suggests that the text does not offer, or perhaps not primarily, something exotic. You have seen this before. The tense hints that the divide between self and other is more temporal than spatial. In the title, as in certain aspects of the text, the movement from you to them results in a platonic recovery of forgotten knowledge. The conservative implications of this are obvious enough. In place of a dialogical model, or a model in which the I mediates, through the text, between reader and folk, the title seems to offer up the full presence of the text's subjects, such that readers come to know them face to face."
Where Allred sees an implicit before, I see an implicit now. Upon looking at this image, you have seen their faces, you have finished your consumption of them, and you can now view them as existing in some alternative past tense. I also think, as I'll trace in this piece, that there are ways in which the dichotomization of you and them that he seems to lay out becomes obfuscated as the process of interaction, particularly with the images, continues on. Though in his 1937 reflection on You Have Seen Their Faces, Alan Maxwell suggested that
"some of these faces and those captions will stay with one a long, long time."
I will first demonstrate how the process of vision, namely of rendering sharecropping communities into spectacles for consumption, becomes refused by the folks depicted in these images. Let us turn first to the first image in You Have Seen Their Faces. The image presents us with a young boy pushing a tool. His body is contorted towards the left, creating a simulation for the reader that he did not stop working for his image to be captured, that the photographer simply entered the scene with little to no intrusion. Of course, we can and should problematize this illusion and can question the circumstances around the photograph, but for the sake of this project, what I am deeply interested in is the ways in which the juxtaposition of lightness and darkness mystifies the face of the young boy. Even as we, and I might also trouble my own language of we and its assumption of a discursive collective that simply cannot exist, begin to scrutinize the image more closely, we come to recognize that we have not really seen the face of this boy. Obscured by shadows, the face is practically an illusion, with the subtle hint of a nose, with the gentle curves of lips, with a sharp suggestion of angles. But we do not get nose or lips or cheeks, and perhaps most critically, we do not get eyes. The eyes are perhaps the most hidden behind shadows, as though the subject himself, in the process of turning, not only marks a refusal to face the photographer, but a refusal to see the photographer. Despite the fact that Maxwell says that
"some of these faces
will remain for the reader, the faces themselves refuse to see and be seen." Not only do the subject of Burkwhite's photographs refuse to see, but they also refuse to be consumed. In a series of stills of a young child eating watermelon, we become witnesses to the mobility of the body, to the ongoing contortion of the child's flesh, the gentle bend of his arms, the soft clench of his jaw, and the tender grasp of his fingers. The watermelon itself marks the sort of consumption that we're, at first, invited to partake in. Just as the child ingests, so too do our eyes consume the child, rendering him spectacle to be understood through our own eyes. By the third image, however, the literal object of consumption, the watermelon, is the entity that hides the face of the child and refuses his visual consumption. In a sense, the watermelon becomes the entity that metaphorically encapsulates the ways in which objects of consumption need shielding and yet can always already function as their own shields. His act allows us to question, how do the objects of consumption directly intervene in the process of rendering them spectacle such that they produce an imminent and obvious refusal of sight? How do the folks in the images, as supposed objects for visual consumption, use their bodies as a means of refusing the ways in which categories of you and them become challenged through vision? We can see this most clearly, I think, in the moments not when there is a refusal of vision, but where vision is made completely apparent. In the image captioned, "I've Only Been Misbehaving," the reader finds herself facing a young black person, clearly behind bars of some sort. Unlike other people throughout the book, this person, who I may gender he for clarity and ease, but whose gender isn't totally clear, looks back at the viewer. In so doing, his eyes catch the viewer's attention, and at least to me, become what Roland Barthes terms the punctum, that part of the image that pricks the soul of the viewer and draws her in more fully. As I look at the image, I do not just consume it, but I find myself consumed by his eyes. His gaze becomes refracted, such that the meaning of "you have seen their faces" becomes inverted. I am them, and he is you, in ways that affirm the dialogic process of looking. As Paula Rabinowitz suggests, the image allows us to question.
When a middle-class woman looks across her class privilege at another person, what does she see? And because she herself is always also an object under investigation, how is she seen in turn? Can a working-class person see herself? And because she is already under surveillance, might she refuse to look at others?
In other words, the image actually bridges the gap between you and them, such that I am forced to confront the ways in which my subjectivity always already is constructed through the gaze of another who is willing to render me object. To borrow the language of my religion pieces, which grapples with similar concerns regarding the process of viewership more broadly, we find that, by calling immediate attention to the spectacle of the human and to the ongoing ways in which social subjects constantly feel the forces of hyper-scrutiny influencing their relationship to others and the world around them, the image allows the viewer the opportunity to refract and understand her own body as those of the image's subject. In a word, the image allows the viewer to recognize how, just as she peers at the sharecropper, she herself is constantly surveyed, analyzed, and understood through others' gazes. The viewer thereby comes to recognize how she exists in highly mediated spaces, constantly navigating interstitial positionalities between gazing subject and gazed upon object. So what is at stake in this reading of "You Have Seen Their Faces"? What would it mean to never have seen their faces, to have been refused the chance to see them, to have lingered on the horizons between you and them all along? To my mind, the visual apparatuses offered by Burkwhite and Caldwell allow readers to recognize, on the one hand, that their own subjectivities could be perceived as incidental to others, and on the other hand, that because they hold their own subjectivity near to them, they ought to respect other subjectivities too. What I mean to suggest here is that "You Have Seen Their Faces" allows for the complication of boundaries, such that when you become them and they become you, the reader is invited to see the humanity of her contemporaries across the bounds of race, gender, class, and ability. While we might recognize the deeply troubling nature of some of "You Have Seen Their Faces" and should not necessarily glorify its documentary practices then, vision functions in the text as a means for disrupting the categorical othering that has plagued and continues to plague the American social imaginary.